Hello, John Talley here with Partzilla.com, and today we're going to be focused in on installing a Racetech gold valve system on the rear shock of our 2005 CRF450R. Now, we already know who the rider is, so I've already built up both the compression and the rebound stacks, and as you can see, you'll have a few shims left over, but hey, this kit is designed to cover a wide range of setups, so you can expect that. We also have the correct spring rate for the rider and his intended use of this particular machine. And it's really not that tough to do, so there's nothing to be afraid of. So let me get this table out of the way, bring over our teardown bench, and then I'll show you how to get it installed. All right, guys, so here we go. Like I said, this is not a very difficult procedure. When you buy the kit, when it shows up, definitely hold on to this one particular piece of paper, because that has your access code. When you go to the Racetech website, you enter in that code, and then it generates a setup sheet depending on your specifications. What that is going to give you is the shim stack for the compression, the rebound, any bleed holes that you may need to be drilled. And they even give the setups as far as your compression and rebound and even your sag setting, depending on your rider weight. So this is the pretty much the chart that we used to determine and then pick out our shim stack, which I've already done. Using just a regular caliper, you measure the outer diameter and the thickness, and then stack them as you go. Now, for the setup instructions for our spec sheet, they call for a 1.6 millimeter piston bleed hole. And where that is gonna be is right here. You can see where they started to drill through. But now we just need to complete it with the right size drill bit. Now 1.6, that should equate to a 1/16 inch, if memory serves. So let's go ahead and start out by drilling that out and just being very careful not to leave any shavings when we're done. All right, guys, you can do this freehand if you want to, but I would recommend using a drill press, because where that comes out, there's not a lot of a margin for error. Now what I want to do here is make sure there are no edges that need to be sanded or filed off, and that there are no shavings anywhere. So we're going to clean it up with a little bit of suspension clean, and then we can continue. All right, guys, let's start putting our shaft together. We're going to go back with the original parts, and then we're going to add in the necessary shim stacks. So all this is as you took it apart. And once again, if you need help getting this apart and putting it back together, reference our playlist and I'll walk you through the entire process. Next, let's get on our base plate. And these came out of the original shock. So that thin one first and then the actual base plate. Right now we can get on our compression stack, and this one is a two stage. So there is that oddball crossover one that's actually sandwiched in here. So let's see if we can get these to go on without making a big mess. Next, we can get in the piston, and we want the six ports facing down into the compression stack. So that's those right there. All right, now let's get our rebound stack on, our three ports facing up. All right, let's see what that left us on our stack height. I'll go ahead and tell you it's going to be too short because we can't run out of thread. So we need to close that distance with spacers. And they're going to go down here. And I can tell you that one is not going to do it. See that area there? We need to be right at the halfway point. So we will probably end up using both of these spacers that came with the kit. So let's get that out of the way. Carefully take our piston as well as our shim stack off completely. Our compression side. Now, go back on, put on our two spacers. Now, let's reinstall our shim stack. Piston, rebound. Now the base, that's what we want. So now we're not gonna run out of thread and we can torque it appropriately. Now granted, this is a new shaft that I'm using. Yours, if you were reusing it, had already been filed down all the way around. So you would definitely want to use red Loctite, and we're going to use that as well just to make sure. Now the kit comes with red Loctite, but I've got plenty around. Word of warning here, don't put an excessive amount because we do not want any Loctite swirling around the internals of our shock. So just put a little bit directly on the threads of the nut itself. And then once we get this tightened down, wipe off any excess that's on the threads of the shaft itself. All right, this is critical. Make sure you're using a good torque wrench. And in our DVS settings, it says to torque it to 25 foot-pounds. So that's where we're heading. I think that's going to be good enough. Looking good. Looking really good. And just to make sure there was no contaminants that got in, we're going to go to this port on the side and blow through the shaft. So honestly, guys, this is nothing to really be afraid of. Just take your time. Make sure you've got enough clearance to where you don't run out of threads and you should be good to go. And this is going to be totally worth it for the environment this machine is going to be ridden in. It's going to make a huge difference in ride quality. All right, next we have an O-ring that came with the kit. All right, guys, now we just need to take a look at it. And what we're looking for is to make sure that our outer shims completely cover the ports for both the rebound and the compression side. And they do. So this looks really good. Other parts you can see is the crossovers in there. So there's just a little bit of gap where my fingernail is here. And then another one up top where that crossover one is. So this is ready to go. All right, guys, we're gonna put this one together a little bit differently than I did in the rebuild video. I'm actually gonna follow Racetech's assembly instructions just for something different. Let's check to make sure she's backed out all the way, because this one is brand new. Yep. All right, what we're going to do is fill it up from this direction until it overfills the bladder section ever so slightly. I'm just letting that equalize now. All right, we've got it filled to about right here. They aren't quite equalized, but that should be enough in there to where it'll just overflow a little bit when we put in the reservoir, because that's what we want. We want to try to get as much air out around it as possible. Yeah, that was more than enough. We could have gone down to here, but let's go ahead and go. This will get messy. You can count on it. You want to get it down just below that edge to where we can get our retaining clip in there. The silver clip. Now, let's go ahead and pull it up into position. And the good part is there shouldn't be any air anywhere in there with this technique. Now let's go ahead and put a little bit of pressure on this in 30 PSI. We just want to overexpand the bladder to force it out against the walls. That'll make it more accurate as far as the amount of fluid we're putting in here. That should do it. Well, 28.5. As long as it's over 25, we'll be fine. Now we want to fill up the main reservoir or the main shock body until it's about 2 inches from the top. We're actually already pretty close. Doesn't have to be exact. I just want to get it close. Now before we put the assembly back together, very important that you go ahead and get the locking rings to set the sag onto the main body, because they will not go on after the fact. So let's grab our assembly and our, they call this a ring. Trick is to make sure it stays in the groove as you're installing it into the body. Also make sure that you had a layer of suspension fluid on that O-ring to make it easier to get in there. Nice. That looks like I overfilled it a little bit, but that'll be okay. Oh, that was really close. Look at all those bubbles coming out. Trick is to draw it up slow, but don't bring it past that hole on the side of the shaft. Otherwise, it'll pull in air and you'll have to start over again. So we want to bring it down with a fair amount of force and bring it up slowly. All right, at this point, we want to get a dead blow mallet and actually shock it as we push it down. That's going to force out more air that may be trapped in between the individual shims. I think that we've got it. I'm not feeling or hearing any more air escaping, and I don't see any more either. All right, so now we can bring the seal head down, and about as far as we're going to be able to get it is where the O-ring is going to start to seal. Now, once it tries to seal, then we'll push it down further while releasing pressure on the bladder. Otherwise, it's not going to go down. There's a bleed hole over here on this side. I want to lean it back to where air can escape right through there. Take your time. See, it's bubbling out right there. I think that's got it. There it goes. All right, so here's the trick. We've got pressure on here. We're going to release pressure on the bladder, and the seal head is going to drop down in there. Now, we can tap it down below and get a retaining clip in there. We are there. Get our clip in. Make sure that it is seated all the way around. All right, let's pressurize it one more time and make sure that that seal head seats correctly against that retaining clip. And the shaft should also extend up all the way if it isn't already. We'll put about 25 or 30 in there. There it goes. Now we can get our cap in place, and you want one of the weep holes, there's two, to be facing forward and aft. All right, now let's depressurize the bladder while pushing in on it. So we want to get as much air out as possible, so we're only putting in nitrogen. So we're going to collapse it. All right, that should have collapsed it in. And now we're actually ready to fill it. Now, if you don't want to go through this process, just take it to your local dealership and have them fill it up. And we are going to be taking it to 165 PSI. All right, here's where the fun begins. Now, granted, the reg is fairly expensive, so you may just want to take this to your dealer and have them do it. 150, 165. That's it. Ready to rock. That feels really good. I'm happy. If I remember correctly, that's on the same side, so we're good to go. Let's go ahead and get our spring on. So it's the larger side down. Get our clip in, retaining clip that is. Make sure it's seated all the way around. Yep, that should do it. Let's lay it down and get our preload set. So we want to set this to 7 millimeters. So that's going to be just over a quarter inch, maybe to 5/16, somewhere in there. But this just gets us in the ballpark. The owner can set the sag, you know, when he's actually sitting on the machine. I may even send him a Motion Pro tool so he can do that. Let's see where we are. Pretty good guess, John. That's we started at 10.5 and she's in 10 in the corner now. We'll go a little bit more. Now we go ahead and lock that down. Amazing how easy these are to adjust when they're properly lubed up. Good to go. All right, next, let's set our rebound and compression. All right, our high speed compression is going to be 2.5 turns out. So let's bring her all the way in. So 2.5 turns. There's one, two, 2.5. Now our low speed, we're going to do 10 clicks out. Our rebound is going to be 12 clicks out. Well, there it is. All right, guys, one last order of business. Now we are finished. All I have to do now, well, let's go remount it to the bike. Well, listen, if you need any of these parts or others for your machine, why don't you come see us at Partzilla.com and we can get you taken care of. If you have any questions or comments about this video, leave them in the section below and I'll do my best to answer them. And hey, if you like what you see, why don't you go ahead and hit that subscribe button? That way you can keep up with whatever I'm working on next. We just want to say thank you for shopping here with us at Partzilla, and we will see you in the next video. Y'all have a great day.